One may say, when releasing a product to the market, you want to be either exceptional or downright bad. Anything in between is just another forgettable release. And the RX 570, when first released in 2017, was exactly that. A solid 1080p gaming graphics card, even though slightly better than the previous gen RX 470. Sure, it could easily outperform NVIDIA's entry-level GTX 1050 Ti, but it struggled to beat the 3GB version of GTX 1060. Because of this, budget-conscious buyers would either spend a bit more back then for the better RX 580 or stick with their still-capable but older graphics cards. Furthermore, the RX 500 series debuted during the cryptocurrency mining boom, which led to a surge in demand for GPUs and consequently inflated their prices. This unfortunate timing meant that even though the RX 570 was a good product, it wasn't quite good enough to justify its high price tag.
These sort of uninteresting refreshes. And man, do you remember when one NVIDIA GPU was like millions of views and people were excited? And now
a pile of
three NVIDIA GPUs.
The GeForce RTX 4070 Ti Super seems about as unnecessary as the name. It is a pretty boring product. And it was, how do I say this? One of my least favorite GeForce 40 series products. 12 gigabytes for $800 US. Not it. It's not a good buy, not a good product.
You can see the trend though. Like GPU launches, it is pretty bad at launch or bad value. It either gets a refresh or the price gets cut in order to fix that mistake. Honestly, a lot of the times it just kind of feels like too little, too late.
So after looking at those results, the biggest thing that stood out to me was that 4GB of VRAM is pretty much out.
What I believe to be definitive proof that 8GB of VRAM is no longer sufficient for high-end gaming. More and more games are using over 8GB of VRAM, particularly at 1440p using high-quality type settings.
If you listen to other people, 8GB of VRAM is complete obsolete garbage, throw it in the trash and get something else. I think it's absolutely correct to say that you should expect or want more than 8GB on a card you're buying in 2023. I think my final conclusion here is that many games use more than 8GB of VRAM, even at 1080p and 1440p.
I did find out how much VRAM you need. It's about 12GB, but I could easily see 12GB not being enough in a few years.
If you want some stances on it as briefly as possible, this launch can largely be summed up with a very advanced word, meh.
7 years have passed, and a lot has changed. Boring next-generation GPU launches and increased costs, performance-boosting upscaling and frame generation techniques, as well as a flood of unoptimized and unreasonably demanding gaming titles have overwhelmed the game industry. Furthermore, since October of 2023, AMD has silently phased out Polaris drivers by reducing the amount of improvements and support for new gaming titles. All the above made people to speculate that by now the RX 570 is probably an outdated product for modern gaming 2024, as it may struggle to run the latest games even at lowest video settings. To discover if that's true, I will test two RX 570 variations. A 4GB ASUS ROG STRIX GAMING and 8GB Dell OEM model. Both cards have the same specifications, with the exception that the ASUS has a slightly higher boost core clock and the OEM card has 4 extra GB of GDDR5 memory, which is theoretically useful for PC games that require a larger VRAM allocation. I've installed these GPUs on an M4 motherboard, paired with a Ryzen 5800X CPU and 32GB of DDR4 RAM, running a fresh installation of Microsoft Windows 10. Alan Wake 2 is one of the first PC games that introduced mesh shader 6.5, which is an advanced rendering technique that is able to mesh up with the performance of any GPU that doesn't support this new feature, including, of course, our RX 570s. Worth noting that both of cards could boot the game, but after a few minutes will crash the desktop due to insufficient video memory. However, the brief time I spent playing the game made it clear to me that a crash to the desktop was an act of mercy. Otherwise, I would have to suffer a slideshow playthrough for a couple of hours. The newly arrived Tekken 8 is pretty playable most of the time. Regrettably, occasional frame drops cause a quite inconsistent gameplay. The problem arises because the game logic is tied to the obligatory 60 frames limiter. Whenever frame drops occur, the game logic reduces the speed of character movements, spoiling the wall fighting experience. Ghost of Tsushima is another console port released recently that even at 1080p lowest settings will get choppy pretty frequently, running on an RX 570. I experiment a bit more with the 8GB model, increasing the graphics settings, turning on FSR3, enabling frame generation and limiting the game to 30fps. And then, I laid back and reminisced the good old performance of PlayStation 4. Even recent mid-market video games, such as Robocop Rogue City, will make the RX 570 struggle to maintain acceptable performance. At 1080p lowest settings, the frame rate typically remains above 30fps, so a frame cap here might allow you to enjoy a smoother gameplay with slightly reduced responsiveness. Elden Ring is one of the classics that recently sparked fresh interest with a new expansion, Shadow of the Erdtree. At 1080p lowest settings, the 8GB variation of the RX 570 stayed mainly above the 60fps. On the other hand, the 4GB version struggled to stay on the same level. You can also experiment with higher graphics settings, capped frames, upscaler and frame generation tools, but be prepared for a quite laggy playthrough. Following the release of Phantom Liberty expansion, the game engine of Cyberpunk 2077 became more demanding than before. Despite this, both versions of RX 570 have managed to maintain frame rates ranging from the low 60s to low 30s at 1080p with low settings. If you try different optimization techniques, you might be able to enjoy the game at higher resolutions and settings without any issues. However, to ensure smooth gameplay, it's recommended to stick to 30fps limit. Forza Horizon 5 is like that reliable friend you can always count on for a good gameplay experience without countering constant shader compilation, frame drops and transitional stutters. Even at 1080p high settings, the RX 570 was able to stay above 60fps, making Forza Horizon 5 one of the few games in our benchmarking test that you don't need special tricks to have a good time with. The remake of Resident Evil 4 is another well-known video memory vampire. Luckily, the game allows to appease its VRAM appetites by adjusting the video settings. Overall, the game at 1080p lowest settings was considered playable during the tests, with frame rates staying above the low 70s and high 40s. This is one more occasion where you should consider limiting the frames per second for a better gameplay experience. Far Cry 6's built-in benchmark highlights that a 7-year-old RX 570 can handle without any issues AAA games that are not brand new. At 1080p and adjusting the video settings according to the card's VRAM capacity resulted in an average frame rate exceeding 70 frames per second, with 1% lows hovering around the low 60s. For the end, I saved 3 Battle Royale games which have a high number of daily players and are regularly updated. One of those is Fortnite, which since its transition to Unreal Engine 5 has become even more, you know, Fortnite. I tested all 3 reddening modes at 1080p and video settings optimized for competitive play. Overall, you won't have any issues playing Fortnite at an RX 570. A useful tip here is that if you want better graphics quality and smoother gameplay, opt for DirectX 12 mode. Otherwise, choose Performance mode for higher frame rates. Our cards perform just fine also on Apex Legends, utilizing its reliable DirectX 11 at 1080p and mainly low settings. The frame rate remained well above 100fps and even in most demanding moments only dipped briefly to around 70fps. Just be mindful to adjust the game's texture streaming budget setting based on the amount of video memory available on your graphics card. Back in the day, Counter-Strike was so lightweight, it could practically run with just a screen and a game controller connected on a potato. But after the Source 2 engine update, its performance nosedived, particularly on older or less powerful graphics cards. Under my tests, both two RX 570 graphics cards maintained an average frame rate of over 100 frames per second running at 1080p Pro settings, even on demanding maps like Ancient. The only problem was some very rare transient stutters that negatively affected the 0.1% lows, which dipped into the low 30s. Definitely, you can still enjoy the competitively Counter-Strike experience, just don't expect the extremely high frame rates of you could achieve in the past. That train has left the station a long time ago. Out of the 12 games of benchmarking sheet, only Alan Wake 2 was unplayable. The rest of the games that released after 2022 could run, but I had to significantly reduce the graphics quality to maintain the average frames per second at acceptable levels. In contrast, I was able to play seamlessly all the Battle Royale and couple of AAA games at native 1080p resolution. I just had to be aware for any VRAM limitations and adjust the settings accordingly. Talking about VRAM, the 4GB difference between the two cards I benchmarked wasn't a significant factor in terms of gaming performance. Any observed discrepancy was likely a very small difference in 1% and 0.1% lows, slightly favoring the 8GB version. This is mainly because the primary limiting factor while testing the RX 570 was the performance of graphics processing unit, rather than the amount of video memory. In conclusion, 7 years ago, AMD's mid-range Polaris GPU was a solid option for 60fps 1080p gaming with few compromises in video settings. However, in 2024, if you want to play the latest and greatest demanding PC games, the RX 570 will barely offer 30 frames per second at the same resolution, even with the lowest graphics quality settings. Applying advanced upscaling techniques and frame generation boosters will not significantly improve performance. From this point of view, purchasing an RX 570 today would be a pointless buy. On the other hand, if you are more interested in exploring the rest of the endless library of PC games, both new and old, including mods and emulated games, then a used Radeon RX 570 graphics card, especially an 8GB model, could be a great choice. Keep an eye out for similar performance level Polaris cards like the RX 580 or RX 480, which might be available at comparable prices or even less. However, be aware that these used graphics cards may have been subjected to heavy use of cryptocurrency mining over the past 8 years. These potentially have shortened significantly their lifespan, and their condition is an important factor to think about when making your purchase decision. Of course, you might also decide to take a look at some other budget-friendly graphics cards that I'm discussing in some of my other YouTube videos on this channel.